Well, good morning. Welcome to Central Trinity. All those of you who are gathered here in person, welcome. Those of you that are watching this morning online, welcome. Or those of you that may be watching this afternoon, welcome. We hope that you are ready to receive a blessing from God as we enter into his presence and invite him to have his way in our lives and this day. As we begin together, I would like to offer up a prayer. Dear God, our Lord, our Heavenly Father, the creator and sustainer of all that is, Lord, we thank you for the regular participation in our lives of your presence, and God, for the opportunity for us to regularly participate together in seeking you in worship. God, we ask that you would just bless us with your presence, pour yourself out upon us, may your Holy Spirit have free reign, God, in this place and in each of us. Lord, and wherever we are this day, Lord, that we are coming together as the family of God, seeking to draw closer to you, to get to know you a little bit better, to love you a little more, and God, to receive your love in even greater ways. Lord, we offer you this time now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church. Would you please stand and join me in singing our opening hymn, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee, found on page 89. We will do verses 1 and 4.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee.
standing for our Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Rainbows made? A rainbow is made when rain and water, rain and sunlight come together. So at the end of a storm, as the sunlight starts to come out, they hit each other and we end up with this beautiful rainbow. Well, a couple days ago, it was raining quite a bit in the morning, and I needed to go to the store, but I didn't want to because that rain was messy. I didn't want to go out in that. Sometimes our lives are kind of messy like that. We kind of get storms in our lives. We make some bad choices. We find ourselves in trouble, and it's a mess. Sometimes when we read stories about people in the Bible, we think that it happened so long ago that they couldn't possibly have anything to do with us. But that's not true. They were people just like us, and they got in trouble just like us. They made bad choices. They found themselves in a mess, kind of like a rainstorm. But every single time, throughout the Bible and still today, when God's people found themselves in trouble and then turned away from their mistakes, turning back to God, he was right there, ready to forgive them and ready to make their mess into something beautiful. When the God of light, the light of the world, meets us in our messy lives, he can make something beautiful out of it, just like the storms turn into a rainbow when they hit the light. Pastor Steve's going to come and he's going to talk about Noah. You know that story, the guy that had all the animals on the boat, and at the end of the story, there's a rainbow. I want you to listen for what he's going to say and watch in your lives for the rainbows. When you get into a mess and it feels like you're in a storm, remember that God can change that mess into something beautiful. When his light comes in contact with our mess, we end up with something beautiful.
Our prayer hymn this morning can be found on page 328, Surely the Presence of the Lord, verse 1.
Place.
That's an encouraging word, not only in this place now with us, but in our lives each and every day, to be reminded that we are never alone. Well, as we move into a time of prayer this morning, maybe lifting up things that are on your heart, things that you can pray and spend some time in that personal time with God, I just want to give a quick update. I mentioned Nyoka Kirkbride last week, and she is home doing well, and so that's a praise. And it's also praise, you know, the individual that had the positive test a couple of days after 2 weeks ago service, why we decided to take a break last week. They're doing pretty well, and I heard nothing else about anybody related to the church, so I give praise God to that. And it's good to see you and have many of you back with us this morning in person at CT. And so just to continue to lift up the Kirkbrides, Gene did end up getting tested positive as well, but he is doing well and has been at home throughout. So we give God thanks for that, and just a continuing hand upon us as we kind of navigate the reality of the world that we are in, even as we pray that God will lead us through it to the other side of it. Just want to encourage you to take a moment now, lifting up your hearts and your prayers and thanksgiving to God. And then I'll offer up a corporate prayer, and we'll join together in the Lord's Prayer. But please take advantage of this time to spend in the presence of God. Let's pray. Oh God, we thank you for the opportunity in these moments and any time to spend with you in prayer, in your presence, God, sharing our heart and seeking to discern yours. Lord, spending time with your Holy Spirit, your Spirit, and just being able to allow that connection that we have with you to find even greater meaning, Lord, drawing us even closer to yourself. Thank you, God, for that promise of always being with us in these moments that we call prayer. God, we do lift up those in the life of our church for whatever reason that are experiencing challenges, whether those are physical challenges or relational challenges or financial challenges, or maybe, Lord, just spiritual or emotional, just kind of wrestling, Lord, with the world in which we find ourselves. God, just thank you that you are with us, and we pray a special blessing upon all those, God, who are dealing with anything, Lord, which is probably about all of us, that need your hand somehow to be active at work in our lives, in our world. And we certainly lift up those that have been mentioned as well. God, we pray that you'd be with our church as we continue to navigate throughout 2021, Lord, and just asking your divine guidance and direction. We certainly, Lord, are looking forward to a day that we pray will not be too far down the road, where the coronavirus situation, at least as we're experiencing it presently, will be resolved and in a better place. Lord, we ask that you would help us to continue to be your light into the community and world in which we live. We pray, dear God, that you might allow us to continue to extend the message and the hope of Christ, Lord, to our community that, Lord, we've been doing here at Central Trinity for 150 years. And we pray, Lord, we'll continue to shine from this place for another 150 and more, if you don't return first. We want that to be, God, the legacy of our church in this community and beyond. And God, as we continue in this moment of prayer and this time together, we ask also that you would bind us as one, as we lift up as one, that prayer that you taught your earliest followers to pray, and that we pray now. May we pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. That is a message that we need to hear in this day and age in which we find ourselves, right? We consider God's goodness in all things. How can we keep from singing? Well, I'm going to be reading a passage from Genesis chapter 6 in the Old Testament of the Bible. Pretty familiar story, as Kiffin had mentioned a moment ago, the story of Noah and the worldwide flood. Hear these words from the Word of God, Genesis chapter 6, verses 5 through 22. The Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. The Lord regretted that he had made human beings on the earth, and his heart was deeply troubled. So the Lord said, I will wipe from the face of the earth the human race I have created, and with them the animals, the birds, and the creatures that move along the ground, for I regret that I have made them. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. This is the account of Noah and his family. Noah was a righteous man, blameless among the people of his time, and he walked faithfully with God. Noah had three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight and was full of violence. God saw how corrupt the earth had become, for all the people on earth had corrupted their ways. So God said to Noah, I am going to put an end to all people, for the earth is filled with violence because of them. I am surely going to destroy both them and the earth. So make yourself an ark of cypress wood. Make rooms in it and coat it with pitch inside and out. This is how you are to build it. The ark is to be 300 cubits long, 50 cubits wide, and 30 cubits high. Make a roof for it, leaving below the roof an opening 1 cubit high all around. Put a door in the side of the ark and make lower, middle, and upper decks. I am going to bring floodwaters on the earth to destroy all life under the heavens, every creature that has breath of life in it. Everything on earth will perish. But I will establish my covenant with you, and you will enter the ark, you and your sons and your wife and your sons' wives with you. You are going to bring into the ark 2 of all living creatures, male and female, to keep them alive with you. 2 of every kind of bird, of every kind of animal, and of every kind of creature that moves along the ground will come to you to be kept alive. You are to take every kind of food that is to be eaten and store it away as food for you and for them. And Noah did everything just as God commanded him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, welcome back to our current message series, Read the Bible for Life, which I hope and pray will inspire us to greater participation, even on a daily basis, getting into the world and to getting into the word and understanding it and applying it to our lives. So both reading it and reading it well, which basically just means to understand what you're reading in that particular location in light of the overall biblical story, the overall account of Scripture from beginning to end. That helps us to better understand and apply what's going on in that specific situation. As we continue this morning with that kind of as our goal, I want to look specifically at the Old Testament of the Bible. And I've chosen to share on a story from the Old Testament about a worldwide flood, that of course being the story of Noah and the Ark. But we're going to do this just a little differently than perhaps you've heard this story spoken about in the past. We're going to look at the big picture. And what I mean by that is we're going to use the account of the flood. We're going to get into the flood, but we're going to use that as an example to illustrate the major themes, some broader themes that we see throughout the stories of the Old Testament. There's a reason that we see major themes appearing again and again throughout the Old Testament, because they're important. When we see major themes or ideas repeated, it's kind of like God saying, hey, this is important, pay attention to it. And the reason, I think, in part, that they're so important, these overarching themes, is because in the themes and the stories themselves, they parallel our own lives and our own world even today. Well, because the story of Noah and Ark is one of the most well-known of the Old Testament accounts, it is my hope that it will be easier, a little easier for us to see these major themes and apply the truths from them to our lives than if I chose a more obscure passage from the Old Testament. So let's go ahead and jump right into this pretty well-known account from the Old Testament of God's Word. The first major theme that I see here that I want to emphasize that we see throughout the Old Testament, and this makes sense, but it's that God is always the focus. God is always front and center. Now, in the Old Testament, God is mighty and powerful, and yet passionately loves his creation. God is always ready to lead and to guide human beings as they submit themselves to him and to protect and to bless them. And when they get in trouble, God is always the hero, the one who saves them when they turn to him for their in the midst of their struggles. Again, God is always at the center, always desiring to be in a deep relationship and to lead and to guide his people. It's always front and center in this specific account, in this specific story. And for me, that's a huge, it's of huge importance because it reflects God's love even for us today, God's heart, that God wants to be the center of our stories because he loves us. He knows what's best for us, and he wants his best for our lives. And he invites us into a relationship where he can become the center of our stories and to lead and to guide us. Another key theme from the biblical account from the Old Testament is that there's almost always tension in the story. Typically, at the end of the story, the tension is somehow resolved after God intervenes. But there's always tension. So in the story of the flood, God looks over all of creation. He sees a problem. God sees that humanity has become terribly evil, very wicked. And so he makes this decision that the situation is so far gone. There's so much evil in the world, more than we can possibly imagine. And I would pause here and say, no matter how bad you think things have gotten today, I think they were far worse in this time. And so God gets to the place where there is literally no choice in his mind but to wipe out everything and everyone and basically start from scratch. Let's look at verses 5 and 6 again. The Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. Wow. It says the Lord regretted, in another version or another interpretation of scripture says grieved, that he had made human beings on the earth. And his heart was deeply troubled. It was filled with pain. This is further spelled out in verses 11 through 13, which adds, now the earth was corrupt in God's sight and was full of violence. God saw how corrupt the earth had become, for all the people on earth had corrupted their ways. However, there was one exception. So God said to Noah, I'm going to put an end to all people, for the earth is filled with violence because of them. I am surely going to destroy both them and the earth. Wow. And I say wow, because God created human beings to be in relationship with him, to be loved by him and to love him. But they turned their backs on him. They rejected his love and instead chose to indulge in violence toward one another and in all sorts of other evil activities. And apparently everyone has gotten caught up in it. In fact, it's gotten so completely out of control that God sees little choice but to start over completely. Start over. Now, I have to believe that if there had been any hope for the multitudes of people who were destroyed in the flood, that God would have spared them. But the Bible seems to indicate that the condition was so bad and the evil was so prevalent that there was no hope. That they were set in their ways, belligerent, and not interested in turning away from them. Now, I'm trying to put myself a little bit in the mind of God. And what I mean by that is, I can't imagine how much it must have hurt God by humanity's rejection of him and all the evil and the violence that was occurring on the earth. I mean, the Bible tells us that God literally grieved over the situation, that God's heart was filled with pain. I think of, like, you know, when something so makes you so hurting that it's like that deep lump, you know, that lump that we feel down deep in the pit of our stomach and we just sort of hurt. I mean, that's what I think of in terms of the way that God hurt over the creation that he had created. So God sends this flood, destroys the world and everything and everyone in it, with the exception of Noah and his family, and afterward begins again. So drastic measures were taken, but the tension that existed in the story has been resolved. And now through Noah and his family and all of the animals on the ark, the whole world begins again. And the same pattern of tension, a moment of crisis, God's intervention, and then some form of resolution occurs again and again throughout the Old Testament. And I would suggest that the same pattern occurs again and again in our lives and our world today. Tension arises. We find ourselves in a crisis of some sort. If we lean on God, God intervenes in some way, which at least in our lives resolves the situation. And the tension subsides, or at least recedes for a while, until the next challenge comes along. And the good news is that if we seek God with all of our heart, and we strive to live for him, God will lead us through the tension. And I would add, and even help us to learn to live with it, because we know that sometimes it's a long time until the tension and until the resolution, that better place comes along. The problem is solved, the relationship is improved, the challenge is overcome. And sometimes we also know that there are situations where resolution, at least as we would like it to come, never comes and may not come, at least in this world. It will come eventually, I assure you, but may not fully arrive even in our lives. But even then, I would suggest that God will give us the grace and the strength to learn to live it with it in a way that does not rob us of the joy and the peace and the fulfillment that God makes possible in our lives through a relationship with Christ. That God still offers that even in the midst of the challenge. So we have these first two themes that we see again and again in the Old Testament, that God is the center, the focus, the one that wants to be there for us, the one that wants to guide us through, but we got to lean on him. And then also this tension that arises in situations, a crisis, God intervenes, resolves the situation. We see that in the Old Testament, but we see it in our lives as well. But there's another overarching theme in this story that is found again and again throughout the Old Testament and throughout the Bible as a whole, and it's just absolutely huge. And you can't ask or talk about the major themes in the Old Testament without talking about this, and that's covenant. Covenant. So what is covenant, you may ask? Well, the Bible is really a love story. It's about a special, intimate, loving relationship which exists between God and the human beings he created, or at least all those who truly desire it. I mean, that was always God's purpose for creating human beings. It is why he created us, not to give us rules and guidance and direction. I mean, that's to help us. But God ultimately, when you boil right down to it, he created us to love us and to be loved by us. But the Bible is also a story about love lost and love regained. Again, from the moment that God created human beings, his greatest desire was to be in a loving relationship with them. He committed to love them. However, he also desired that human beings would choose to love him back. He didn't want robots. He wanted friends. And so God gave us this thing called freedom or free will, a choice as to whether or not to seek after God and his ways. Now, unfortunately, when Adam and Eve disobeyed God and first brought sin, which basically just means disobedience to God, into the world, that intimate, loving relationship was lost. It was broken. Nothing was the same because sin in the lives of human beings made it impossible for a perfect God to draw close to we now imperfect human beings. A perfect and holy God cannot interact with sin. It simply cannot exist in God's presence. So this whole Old Testament system of sacrificing animals was put into place as kind of a substitute punishment where the animal paid the price, suffered the consequences for the sin of human beings as kind of a painful reminder of how serious sin and evil were to God, and that ultimately, without forgiveness, sin and evil leads to one thing, death. Now, the sacrificial system, many would say, was gory. Maybe some might call it grotesque. Some might say, unfair to the animal. I mean, they were sort of caught up in it. But it was gory and grotesque and in your face for a purpose, to remind human beings of how gory and grotesque is sin in our lives. Basically, to keep the reality of people's sin in front of them so they wouldn't forget, that they needed God. Apparently, the evil in the world in the time of Noah was also pretty gory and grotesque, or God wouldn't have felt the need to start the human race over. But the system of animal sacrifice was also put into place for another purpose. And that purpose was to remind people that because of the seriousness of sin, a high price had to be paid in order for sins to be forgiven, covered, removed. Basically, that sin has consequences. This also pointed to the one who would eventually come and become the final gory and grotesque sacrifice, if you will, the one whose death would provide permanent forgiveness for sins to all who believe and make an intimate, loving relationship with God possible once again. Covenant in the Bible is all about relationship. And specifically, it pointed to relationship with God and God's promises to human beings. The covenant that God made with Noah and really the whole world, and we find it referred to in Genesis 6 and then actually made in Genesis 9 and following, was the promise marked by a rainbow never to destroy the world by flood again. This was the first reference to covenants in Scripture. And it begins to lay the groundwork for the covenant, the special relationship that God established with the people of ancient Israel. And the covenant, the special relationship eventually made with the whole world to all who would receive it, made possible by what Jesus would do when he gave his life on the cross as the punishment for our sins. The first covenant God established with his people, the system of sacrificing animals as a kind of a substitute punishment for sin, was only a temporary fix for sin. The Old Testament covenant was kind of like a Band-Aid. I don't think God liked it any more than the people did. And, after all, he created those animals. If you want to talk about the animals, if anyone was pained at seeing them sacrificed, it would have been God. The New Testament covenant, then, made through Jesus' death, was the permanent cure. And in fact, the word testament means covenant. So the next time that you read your Bible and you read the words Old Testament and New Testament, try reading it Old Covenant and New Covenant, because that's what it actually means. The Old Testament is all about the Old Covenant, love lost and a temporary fix. The New Testament is all about the New Covenant, love regained, intimacy with God restored. And if you have by faith received God's forgiveness for your sins, you've entered into that new covenant, the special, intimate, and loving relationship with God through Jesus that prior to Jesus' death and resurrection had not been possible since Adam and Eve first disobeyed God back in the Garden of Eden. The theme of covenant runs throughout the stories of the Old Testament. I mean, the Old Testament is the story of God, driven by his incredible love for humanity, working passionately to repair and restore the divide that existed between himself and human beings after humans rejected him and chose to go their own sinful way. Well, I hope that you can see not only in the biblical account of the flood, but in the whole of the Old Testament, these overarching themes of God being front and center, of wanting to lead and to guide our lives, of being there to rescue us. That's kind of one. And then of this idea of tension, of crisis, of intervention and resolution that we experience even in our lives today, and of covenant, God working in the midst of it all to repair the broken relationship with the ultimate pride and joy of his creation, human beings. And here is how you really draw the most from the Old Testament accounts. As you read it and study them, ask yourself, how do I fit into the story? Where am I in all this? Let's take Noah's the story of Noah for an example. Maybe you're not living like that you know you should. I mean, maybe there's things that you just know that, okay, this is probably not where God would want me to be, or this is not what God would desire from me, and it kind of feels like I'm getting away with it and not really any accountability. But like the people of Noah, one day there will be consequences, because there is consequence for sin. Why not get any of those struggles, those things, right out in the open? Now, I don't mean here in church in front of everybody, but I mean open up before God and let him begin to work in those situations. Not only will it bless and benefit your relationship with God, it'll lead to a greater joy and peace and fulfillment in life. Or maybe, here's another way that you could see yourself in the story. Maybe you're like Noah, caught up in the tension of the challenges of life, trying to get through the best you can and dealing with the storms of life, maybe struggling a little. That's probably all of us right now. Be encouraged. Even if God doesn't immediately and miraculously remove the tension, he'll give you a greater peace and joy in the midst of it and the strength to weather every storm. In fact, I know that for me, the storms, the challenges of life are where I grow the most. I don't like them, but they're where I grow the most. I don't want to be in them all the time, but they're where I grow the most. Or maybe, as we look at how we might be in this story of Noah, maybe you just need to be reminded that there is a God who passionately loves you and who worked over several thousand years to repair the great divide that existed between himself and we human beings, so that you could love him intimately and so that you could be loved intimately by him. If you've taken God up on that offer of a relationship with Jesus, thank him now. And if you haven't, would you give him your love and your life right now by simply acknowledging that you're not perfect? That ought to be an easy one for all of us. And that you're in need of God's forgiveness. And then by faith, receiving that forgiveness and inviting him into your life even today. For you see, when it comes to the stories of the Old Testament and the story of God, that is the big picture. Let's pray. Dear God, we're so grateful that you have been working for thousands of years since human beings turned away from you to bring them back to you. God, thank you for the opportunity that you make possible for all human beings to come into a relationship with you through your Son, Jesus Christ, and made possible by Christ's sacrifice on the cross for our sins. And God, thank you that even beyond that, even when we've already received you into our lives and received by faith that forgiveness, that your arms are always open wide, inviting us to come deeper and to draw closer. God, thank you for giving us your word, the Bible, that helps us to learn more about you and, quite frankly, helps us to learn more about us. Helps us to understand, God, your role in our lives throughout history and what your desire is for us even going forward. And God, in the midst of just kind of everything in our lives and in our world, may we know that you are there, ready to receive us, to strengthen and encourage us, to walk through walk with us through the tensions and the challenges in our lives, and to lead us to better places, not only beyond this life, but even in it. God, may we always seek to be in a responsive attitude toward your calling, your wooing, your drawing us closer to yourself. I often say, God, we love you, and I don't say that just because that's a thing to say, God. I hope we love you with all of our heart, because you sure love us. And we praise you and thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you please stand and join with me in singing our closing hymn, How Great Thou Art, found on page 77. We will do verses 1 and 4.
Bible does indeed promise that one day Jesus will return to this world in power and glory, and every tongue confess and every knee shall bow. But until that time, or until he calls us home to be with him, I want you to know that the greatest power that exists in our world, the greatest strength, the greatest hope, the greatest joy, the greatest peace, comes through a relationship with God. And God is always offering us more through his word, through prayer, through connecting with the faith community. And God says that no matter how crazy the world gets, it's going to be okay if you let me lead and guide your life. I'll walk you through the tension. I'll give you strength for the journey. And we'll do this thing together and with the people that I have placed around you in the name of Christ to walk with you. And so as you go out into the world this week, know, claim that, receive that. That's something that God has said I've made possible through Christ in your life. Be encouraged and strengthened in all things that you do not go alone. In fact, you are never alone when Christ is with you. So have a wonderful week. We look forward to seeing you again real soon. And just seeing what God is going to do, even in the midst of the world in which we currently experiencing or are experiencing. Have a wonderful week, joy-filled week, peace-filled week. In Jesus' name, amen.